So as we said, my name is Seth Muhima Mubarake. So she got it. And I am the survivor of the genocide against Tutsi in the one in 1994.
Can you speak up a little bit, please?
Oh.
This is a dead space.
So. You hear me? Okay. So, first of all, allow me to express my profound gratitude to all of you for attending this evening for the 6th annual Genocide Memorial Service in Edmonton. I take this opportunity to thank Reverend Audrey Brooks for inviting the Memory Keepers Association of 1994 Genocide against Tutsi of Rwanda here in Edmonton to come this evening and share with you our sad history. As you know, Rwanda is a small country located in Central Africa. We have four neighbors countries. At the north, we have Republic Democratic of Congo, East Uganda, West Tanzania, and South Burundi. Rwanda was called a country of thousand hills because of its beautiful nature. However, Rwanda was covered in 100 days with dead bodies on streets, schools, churches, and rivers. And our hearts were filled with heartbreak and desolation. Every April, we choose to take this time to remember and honor the memory of over 1 million souls slain under the cruel hand of their fellow compatriots. We gather together the Tutsi who were killed because of who they were. We also remember foreign citizens who perished just because they refused to take part in this extermination of the Tutsi or Hutu who were brutally massacred while protecting the Tutsis. Each year, the Memory Keepers Association continue to choose to revisit this painful past, gathering together, comfort each other as survivors of this 20th century genocide. We also renew our efforts as Rwandans to preserve our young generation from future atrocities. Ladies and gentlemen, the genocide planification started long time ago with the divisionism of the people who live together with one religion, one culture, one language, all shared one land. This Makeba ideology was introduced by the colonizers, including the Belgian Catholic priest. According to the analysis of first colonizers to Rwanda and Burundi, Germany first and Belgium later, the population of Rwanda and Burundi were divided into three ethnic based classes, Hutu, Tutsi, and Twa. By then, the ethnic breakdown of the nation is roughly 84% of Hutu, 15% Tutsi, and 1% Twa. Hutu were considered socially inferior to Tutsis. I'd like to inform you that Rwanda was under the Germanic power before the International Conference of Berlin, which took place in February 26, 1985 in Berlin, where the objective it was to see how the continent of Africa can be divided by different countries of Europe. After this meeting, the Belgium was in charge of Congo, Rwanda, and Burundi. They named those countries Congo, Rwanda, Burundi as one thing, but there was differences. Breakdown of social fabrics under Belgian occupation since 1918 to 1962. Belgians have replaced more than 1,000 years of Rwandan's lifestyle by European one. They intentionally convinced the Hutu majority to see themselves as oppressed by the Tutsi minority, and the road of hatred was paved forever. One of the tools which facilitated the Hutu to exterminate Tutsi during the genocide, it was the ethnic identification card installed in 1933 by the Belgium. This card with a picture indicated that you are Hutu, Tutsi, or Twa, and was used to classify one's ethnicity. That's why people were asked an ID card on roadblock during the genocide. We don't have enough time to explain in details the whole story since in 1933 to 1944, where the genocide started. I just want to clarify this quotation. As mentioned and emphasized by Gregory Stanton, before the genocide happened, there is 8 stages of genocide which must be completed: classification, symbolization, dehumanization, organization, polarization, preparation. All 6 are warning signs, and 2 more signs of execution: extermination and denial. All 8 stages were completed in Rwanda. Now, we are experiencing the last stage, which is the denial of the genocide against Tutsi in Rwanda. We, as the survivors, we cannot tolerate any actions and tentative of denying where and anyhow this can occur. We think that we work together as human beings to discourage these activities. I liked very much how our brother said, now today, human is killing human. And as human, what can I do? In April 6, 1994, the President Habyarimana and the President of Burundi, Cyprien Ntaryamira, are killed when Habyarimana's plane is shot down near Kigali Airport. Extremist Hutu, suspecting that the President is finally about to implement the Arusha Peace Accords, are believed to be behind the attack. That night, the systematic killing of Tutsi and moderate Hutu begins. April 7, 1994, the Rwandan armed forces and the Interahamwe set up roadblocks and go from house to house, killing Tutsi and moderate Hutu politicians. Thousands died on the first day. UN forces stand by while the slaughter goes on. They are forbidden to intervene, as this would break the monitoring mandate. April 8, 1994, the RPF, Rwandese Patriotic Force, launches a major offensive to end the genocide and rescued 600 of its troops surrounded in Kigali. The troops had been based in the city as part of Arusha Accords. April 21, the UN cuts its forces from 2,500 to 250 following the murder of the 10 Belgian soldiers assigned to guard the Hutu Premier Minister Agathe Willing-Yiman. The Premier Minister is killed and the Belgians are disarmed, tortured and killed. They had been told not to resist violently by the UN force commander, as this would have breached their mandate. April 30th, the UN Security Council suspends 8 hours discussing the Rwanda crisis. The resolution condemning the killing omits the word genocide. Had the term been used, the UN would have been legally obliged to act to prevent and punish the perpetrators. Meanwhile, tens of thousands of refugees fly into Tanzania, Burundi, and Zaire. In one day, 250 Rwandans, mainly Hutus, flying the advance of the RPF, cross the border into Tanzania. May 17, 1994, as the slaughter of the Tutsis continues, the UN agrees to send 6,800 troops and policemen to Rwanda with powers to defend civilians. A Security Council resolution says act of genocide may have been committed. Deployment of the mainly African UN forces is delayed because of arguments over who will pay the bill and provide the equipment. The United States agreed with the UN over the cost of providing heavy armored vehicles for the peacekeeping forces. June 22nd, with still no sign of UN deployment, the Security Council authorizes the deployment of French forces in southwest of Rwanda. They create a safe area, dubbed Zone Turquoise, in territory controlled by the government, but killing of Tutsis continue in the area. The United States government eventually uses the word genocide. In July 1994, the RPF captures Kigali. The Hutu government flies to Zaire, or Republic Democratic of Congo, followed by a big number of refugees. The French end their mission and are replaced by Ethiopian UN troops. The RPF sets up an interim government of national unity in Kigali. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not easy to talk about Rwanda in history in short time, 12 minutes, I guess, as we have. I have given you a short idea how things went up to genocide in 1994. Maybe you get enough time to go in deep and explain more about our history. 20 years ago, Rwanda succumbed to a 100 rainy days of horror, flooded in the blood of victims and in the tears of survivors. Today, Rwanda emerged and her citizens are rebuilding the country that was destroyed. 20 years ago, the right to life was denied by genocide perpetrators. Today, Rwanda is committed to fight all revisionists who have fought to deny its citizens the right to remember. Rwanda is committed to fight against these forces that continue to obstruct the truth of what happened in 1994, hoping that their sins will slip away in intervening years. 20 years ago, Rwandans were abandoned, first by its own army killing its own people. Second, abandoned by the international community and by the UN peacekeepers present in Rwanda at that time and led by the Canadian General Roméo Dallaire. Today, Rwanda is responding to those in distress beyond its borders and is committed to prevent and fight against genocide and other mass atrocities through its participation in peacekeeping operations and through its continued commitment toward the responsibility to protect. The Memory Keepers Association of 1994 Genocide Against Tutsi of Rwanda in Edmonton choose to keep the memory of our beloved ones killed during the horrible tragedy happening in Rwanda after the Never Again said by the UN in 1994, where over 6 million of Jews perished and the world watched instead to react quick and serve many souls of humanity. Every year we do commemorate and remember the genocide against Tutsi in April of each year. In 3 months ago, it was our 20th commemoration. After 100 days, the genocide took place. We established a day called Hope Day in July. Now it will be in September 20th. We'll invite you all to come and see how we can see the sun shining and live again with hope and strong vision to seek a better future. Our association decided to inform the world, educate the new generation about this discrimination, humiliation, divisions, and discuss the consequences of these and differences. Maybe our children they will not face what we experienced 20 years later in Rwanda and 69 years for Jewish people. Once again, I'd like to thank you very much for allowing us to share our sad history and to build all together a strong community. And you can say one day, never again is never again anywhere in the world. Thank you.